Good morning, everybody. Happy Friday. We have an amazing show for everybody today. What do we have, Crystal?
Indeed, we do. We got some great panelists, Chuck Rocha, Philip Wegman, Roger Fisk, Rachel Bovard. We have D.C. Congresswoman Eleanor Holmes Norton. She has been so outspoken about the over-the-top security measures in this city, justified based on really nothing. So can't wait to hear that interview. We've got Julia Rock with a report on something actually surprisingly good that Democrats put into the relief bill. But Saagar, what are you looking at first?
So I'm taking a look at this story out of Ohio. It's really been concerning. Let's put this up there on the screen. Essentially, the United Auto Workers is accusing Ford, the Ford Motor Company, of greed and violating a contract with a plan to send jobs to Mexico. So this concerns an Ohio assembly plant where Ford had committed a full $900 million investment. They were going to employ 1,700 workers and have those 1,700 workers to work on an electric vehicle. But what they're doing now, according to the UAW, is that they have informed them that they are going to move production of that vehicle down to Mexico. Crystal, the reason I think it's important is it just continues to show, look, Trump is gone. You know, Biden may be in office, but the forces that brought Trump to the bear, that hollowed out the industrial Midwest, it's all right there. It's all out in the open. And if a GOP politician is smart, this is exactly the type of thing that he would do. I mean, I remember, and back when I thought Trump might actually do something, whenever he went to that carrier plant, which was going to move to Mexico, whenever he was still the president-elect, and they had decided not to, they eventually did move the plant, just so everybody knows. But at the time, he was like, I saved your jobs. He's like, this is exactly what I'm going to do. I remember thinking that and being like, oh my God, like if he can do that, if he can do these types of things. I mean, but you saw over the course of his presidency, the Lordstown plant, he was unable to do anything with that. Then whatever the hell happened in Wisconsin, what was Foxconn?
Oh, God.
It was like a complete boondoggle. This is how these things generally end up. But that does not mean the opportunity for a politician in order to really step up and protect these jobs is not going to remain there forever. And so I don't think we should ever stop talking about these issues. I mean, these people were promised money. They were promised good jobs. Ford Motor Company, they're doing fine, and they're still trying to move production down to Mexico. I just think it's, look, these are the issues which will always be there for somebody who is smart in order to discuss in our politics.
And obviously, Ohio has a key Senate race.
That's right.
Open seat. Democrats look like they're putting up Tim Ryan. Republicans have a very feisty primary on hands. J.D. Vance may be looking at getting into the race. Got $10 million from Peter Thiel. Something we're talking about here. But that race is really kind of one of the marquee battles for the future of the Republican Party. But on the merits of this thing, I mean, part of what is so unconscionable here is the union, when they were in negotiations with Ford, contract negotiations, look, there are a lot of things that you can, you know, you only have so much you can push for.
Yeah.
So you decide what direction you're going to. Are we going to push for better health care? Are we going to push for higher wages? What are we going to do? And the thing that they really pushed for was job security.
Mm-hmm.
That was the key provision that they felt they won in their contract negotiations, was a commitment to revitalize this plant, to keep the work local and keep these workers employed. That was what they thought they won. And so now the union is calling them out for greed, saying we 100% reject the company's decision to put corporate greed and more potential profits over American jobs and the future of our members. And again, they feel like they were really rolled and lied to in these negotiations. So it truly is unconscionable. And this is a microcosm of what has happened across this country because of, and again, this didn't just happen by accident, because of a bipartisan consensus from Democrats and Republicans that said, hey, if we can up GDP a little bit, if we can help fatten corporate profits a little bit, we really don't care what happens in these towns. We really don't care what happens to these workers. And sure, election time, we'll come parade through their town, we'll tell them what they want to hear, or we'll, you know, win plaudits. This was Obama's move. We'll win plaudits from the Beltway media by telling them the hard truth that their jobs aren't coming back.
Learn
like,
to code.
Yeah, thanks a freaking lot.
Yeah.
Exactly. And then nothing seems to change. It's interesting to think back to those early days of the Trump presidency, because I thought, like you did, when he went to the carrier plant, the liberals were hand-wringing about, like, oh, this is just symbolic and this isn't structural change. That's a legit critique. But on the other hand, that really mattered, actually, to have a president who's willing to go out and make a stand and say, look, I'm fighting back against this. And even those symbolic things, when you're president, do actually matter, and they do actually send a message to companies. But then he doesn't follow up. That one went overseas anyway, when it went to Mexico anyway. Foxconn was a complete mess at the taxpayers' expense, created zero jobs at massive cost. And it was basically, I thought he would do that his entire presidency. And I thought if he did, whether it was justified or not, he'd have like a 65% approval rating. Yeah. But it turned out to be like a one-time deal, and that was it.
Yeah, and I remember Harley-Davidson did the same thing, and he called him out. But then they knew he wasn't going to do anything, so they still moved production. This is exactly the problem. And look, if Biden, he talks, did a whole video on Amazon. This is it too, man. The problem, though, is that most Democrats think Ohio is basically a red state and that Sherrod Brown is like a throw-off. And so I don't know if they're going to speak out against this. But that doesn't mean that it's not important for this country. We have to have an auto industry. If we don't have an auto industry, we're dead. We can't ever produce anything, especially in a time of war. And I just think that it's terrible to watch this happen. Let's be honest, it probably would have happened under Trump, too. And if Biden actually wants to talk a bit, Biden has talked a big game. And if he's serious, I hope he says something about it.
If you want to understand why Sherrod Brown continues to get elected in Ohio, it's because he's all over.
And he's quoted in this story saying this is, you're not going to turn our back on our community. This is how you actually win. Whoever does this, that's how you win.
More Rising for you after this.